Hi, scientists. My name is Troy, and today we'll be taking a closer look at wetlands and some of the bugs that live there. A wetland is any place where the land is covered by water most of the time. There are many bugs that live in wetlands, and today we're going to be looking at some of those bugs to see how they can help us tell if a wetland is healthy or not. For this activity, you'll need a worksheet that your adult will hand you in a minute, a blank piece of paper, a blue and red marker, scissors, and a glue stick or tape. Looking at this wetland, you might notice that the water looks kind of dirty, but that's good for many of the plants and animals that live here. The plants need healthy soil to grow in, and many wetland animals, like bugs, love to crawl around in the mud underwater. Mud and scum are part of a healthy wetland, but not all wetlands are healthy. Sometimes, trash or chemicals that don't belong in the water end up in our wetlands. This is called pollution. We can't always see pollution with our eyes, so scientists have other ways of telling if the water is healthy or polluted. They look at the bugs living in the water. There's a special group of bugs that live in wetlands called aquatic macroinvertebrates. Aquatic means they live in the water. Macro means they are big enough to see without a microscope. And invertebrate means they are creatures that have no backbone. Some aquatic macroinvertebrates are very sensitive to pollution, meaning they can only live in healthy water with good dirt. Others can survive in water that has more pollution in it. If there are lots of sensitive bugs in the water, it's probably a healthy wetland. But if there are very few sensitive bugs in the water, then the wetland probably has too much pollution for them to survive. Today, we're going to explore two pretend water samples. Your job is to figure out which water sample is from a healthy wetland and which sample is from a polluted wetland. In a minute, your adult will pause the video and hand you one of two worksheets. Each worksheet shows a group of macroinvertebrates that someone might have found in an imaginary wetland in Washington State. One says Misty Lake and has wavy lines in the water, and the other one says Pebble Pond and has polka dots in the water. Together, we will investigate what types of bugs are found in each wetland and what those bugs can tell us about how healthy each wetland is. You will work together with a buddy sitting near you. Each person in the pair will get one of the two different worksheets, either Pebble Pond or Misty Lake. Once everyone has their worksheet, you can start cutting out the bug cards on your worksheet by cutting on the dotted lines. Make sure you don't accidentally mix your bugs up with someone else's. Go ahead and pause the video now and turn it back on once everyone has cut out their bug cards. Now comes the fun part. It's time to sort bugs. Each partner will sort the macroinvertebrates found in their wetland so that each pile has one type of bug. To help you tell which bugs are the same, look for body features, like how many legs they have and the shapes of their bodies. Do not use your markers yet, they're for later. Pause now and come back once your macroinvertebrates are all sorted. Nice work, scientists. I don't know about you, but I can't quite tell from these piles how many of each type of bug there are in each wetland. How could we organize these bugs differently to help us look for patterns? I know. Let's make some graphs. To make your graphs, each partner will separately stack their cards up in a straight line, one for each type of bug, like this. Then tape or glue them down onto your blank paper in straight vertical lines so you can see how many bugs of each type you found. Pause the video here and come back once your bugs are taped or glued down in a graph. Remember, each partner is making their own graph for their own wetland sample. Next, you're going to compare your graph to your buddy's graph. Compare means to look for things that are the same and for things that are different. What is the same or different between your two wetlands? I'm going to start a 60-second timer. When the timer starts, you can turn and talk with your buddy. Your teacher can pause the video if they want to give you more time to talk. Okay, start talking to your buddy. Welcome back, everyone. Thanks for sharing all your observations. One difference I noticed is that there are lots of worms in Pebble Pond and lots of caddisflies in Misty Lake. Some of these bugs are more sensitive and need healthy water to survive, and some of these bugs are tough and can survive in polluted water. Let's look at each species of bug and see how well they can survive in polluted water. Maybe then we'll see some patterns to which bugs survive better in which wetland. That can tell us which wetland has healthy water. Go ahead and get out your blue and red markers now. With our red markers, we'll circle bugs that are tough and can survive in pollution. With our blue markers, we'll circle bugs that are more sensitive and cannot survive in polluted water. This isopod is a pretty tough bug. It can eat a decent amount of pollution without getting sick. Circle these bugs in red. The amphipod is also pretty good at surviving in polluted water. Circle these bugs in red as well. The mayflies and most caddisflies are sensitive. They cannot survive in water with much pollution in it. Circle these bugs in blue. Worms are also tough. They can live where there's a large amount of pollution. These bugs should be circled in red. Look at your graph now and compare it again to your buddy's graph. In a moment, your teacher will pause and you will discuss with your buddy which one of your wetlands has healthier water and how you know. You can pause the video now. Welcome back. You might have decided that the water at Pebble Pond with the polka dots is more polluted than the water at Misty Lake with the wavy lines. We know this because there are fewer sensitive bugs in blue living here, and a lot more tough bugs in red. Where sensitive bugs cannot survive, that usually means there is too much pollution in the water. Now that we know which pond has more pollution in it, we can start deciding how to clean up the pollution, so that some of the sensitive macroinvertebrates might slowly come back. People have had to clean bodies of water before. For example, back in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, Lake Washington in Seattle was getting really badly polluted. This caused lots of green scum called algae to grow in the lake. The algae would die off and rot in the lake, making it smell so bad that the newspapers called it Lake Stinko. The whole community had to work together and spend a lot of money and time to clean up the lake by building a sewer plant to keep new pollution out of the water. Often, the whole community needs to work together to clean up a wetland, lake, or river. We need help from scientists and engineers to come up with solutions, politicians to make laws to protect the water, and everyone in the community to make sure the politicians know how important clean water is to them. Our activity is coming to an end now, but when the video turns off, I invite you and your group to discuss what sources of pollution you think might be polluting Pebble Pond, and what the people who work and live nearby can do to help get the water clean for themselves, the water bugs, and everyone else who lives near the lake. Have a great day, scientists, and until next time, stay curious.